Once upon a time, there were three billy goats. There was the baby billy goat. There was the middle billy goat. And there was the big billy goat. They had been eating all spring. But then they noticed they were running out of their fresh green grass. When they looked across the river, the field over there was lush and green. So they decided they needed to go across the river. There was only one bridge, and it was only big enough for one of the goats to cross at a time. But there was the evil troll that lived under the bridge, and he didn't like to let you cross for free. So they were brave, and the littlest baby goat started to cross the bridge. Trip, chop, chip, chop, walking across the bridge. Trip, chop, chip, chop, walking across the bridge.
Who's that tripping over my bridge?
Shouted the troll. The little baby goat said,
"It is I, little baby goat. Please, sir, don't eat me. Wait for my bigger brother. He'll be along in just a minute."
"He's bigger than you? Well, I'm really hungry, so I will wait."
And so the baby little baby goat went across the bridge.
Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge. Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge.
Well, next up was the middle baby goat, or the middle goat. And he was up to cross the bridge.
Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge. Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge.
Who's that tripping over my bridge?
It is I, middle billy goat.
Well, I'm hungry. I'm ready to eat you up.
Oh, no, 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 sir goat. Our troll, please don't eat me up. Wait for my bigger brother. If you're that hungry, he will fill you up. And so the middle goat went across the bridge.
Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge. Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge.
Next came the biggest billy goat. He was barely fitting across the bridge, and his hoofs made big noises when he tried to cross.
Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge. Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge.
Who's that tripping over my bridge? It is I, biggest billy goat. What are you gonna do about it? I'm gonna eat you up. I passed up on two other goats to wait on you.
Well, I'd like to see you try. And they started fighting. The goat backed up and ran toward the troll and headbutted him into the water. And the troll floated away and was never seen again. And the largest billy goat crossed the bridge.
Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge. Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge.
So all the goats were together again on the green side of the river, and they had a lovely day eating grass.
Trip, trap, trip, trap, walking across the bridge.
Hello, hello, and welcome to our show. I'm Aesop, the author and collector of these tales that you will see and hear today. I lived so long ago, I was born around 620 BC. There is not a lot of information about me left. Some people even think that what they did find is made up nonetheless and created with 600 fables or stories. Will you learn our lesson? Today we will explore four such fables and I will tell you more about myself as we go on. Our first fable is The Lion and the Mouse. Never be so high and mighty that you don't think you need help some days. Enjoy!
What a nice afternoon. I think I'll lay down here next to the shade tree and take a nap.
Oh, it is a lion. He is fast asleep.
I see you, Mouse, and I got you, and I'll eat you up.
Oh, please let me go. I didn't mean to wake you. Please don't eat me. I'll be your friend, and someday I can help you.
Ha ha! How could you help me? A little tiny, puny creature like you couldn't possibly help a beast like me.
Please, Great King, don't eat me.
Oh, I'm just too sleepy. If you insist, well then be careful and do not wake me again. Next time I will not be so kind.
I will be careful, Lion. You are very kind and I will be your friend and repay you someday.
I need to hunt today. What is this? Oh no, a trap.
Is that the lion trap?
I am afraid I will not escape this net.
I am here, lion, to help you. Don't worry, I will soon have you out of that net.
How will you get me free?
I will gnaw away at the ropes. No, no, no.
The net is loose. I am free.
There you are. I told you I'd pay you back someday, didn't I?
Amazing. I didn't think it was possible a tiny, puny thing like you could help a king of beasts like me.
Everything is possible, Lion.
Moral. Kindness never has never wasted. So it pays to be kind, or one good deed deserves another.
Wasn't that great? If you did not realize, I use animals or objects to tell my fables. They get treated like they are humans. That is called personification. Speaking of people, how about a little more information about me? Some people say I was born in Greece. Some say somewhere in Africa. And I know I was bullied a lot for being born ugly with a speech impediment. Even though people picked on me, I tried to practice kindness. I was kind to a priestess of Isis, and she granted me my voice and my power to tell stories. Our next story is The Fox and the Crow. Remember, flattery will get you nowhere.
Fox was out for a nice walk one day in the forest.
I think I smell something I like. Well, I think it must be cheese.
Now Crow was sitting on a branch of an old oak tree. Crow had a big chunk of cheese in her beak.
Oh, that looks delicious. I must get it, the cheese for my breakfast. How do I get it?
Then Fox thought of an idea.
Good morning, Crow, you wonderful, gorgeous, wonderful creature.
Crow wasn't completely unwise, and she knew what Fox was trying to do. She didn't say a word. She kept her beak close tight around that cheese.
Wow, I have never seen in my life anything such a beautiful bird as you. Your feathers are so delicate. Your eyes are so sparkly and charming. And your wonderful little feet are so perfect. Your gorgeous, wonderful darling.
Now Crow was listening to every word Fox said, and she loved what she was hearing.
I wonder if real could any creature, even you, be that wonderful? I wonder if you could sing that beautiful tune. Then indeed you'll be the queen of all the birds.
Crow was listening.
No, I believe it will be too much to hope for. You couldn't be that perfect.
I'll show you, Fox. I'll show you how beautiful I can sing. Listen, here.
Crow opened her beak to sing. And you see, crows can't sing. They can caw and they can croak.
Caw! Caw! Croak! Croak! Croak!
As Crow cawed and croaked, the keys fell out of her beak and right down into Fox's mouth.
Yum, this is delicious.
Fox licked his lips and was rather proud of himself.
Crow, how did you get to be that dumb?
Fox started away and Crow was angry as ever. So what is the moral or lesson of this tale?
Don't believe everything you hear. Not everyone has your best interests at heart.
Ha ha ha, the crow should have known better. I did not get much flattery in my time being born ugly and a slave. Oh, don't feel sorry for me after my blessing from Ice is. I was free because I was smart and could write good stories. The King of Lydia sent me on a diplomatic mission to Delphi. Those people were very stuck up and snooty, never satisfied, kinda like the dog in our next story.
One day a dog set out in front of the butcher's shop. The butcher liked this dog and soon he felt sorry for him. So the butcher threw the dog a big meeting bone.
Oh my, this is a great humongous meaty bone. I wonder where I should bury this bone, and a week or two will taste even better.
The dog trotted happily away.
I will cross this footbridge. Hopefully I find a place to bury my bone.
It was then that dog looked down into the water in the river. He was thirsty.
I wonder how I could get a drink of water with this bone in my mouth.
Dog noticed another dog gazing up at him from the water.
Who is that dog? He is bigger than I am, and his bone is bigger too.
Fox thought there was a much bigger dog in the water who had a much bigger bone in his mouth than he had.
That's not fair. Your bone is bigger than mine. I want it.
Dog jumped into the river and tried to grab the other dog's bone. When he did this, the bone in his mouth fell to the bottom of the water.
Oh no, my bone is at the bottom of the water.
Dog did not know until then that there had not been another dog in the water, just his own reflection. He had been rather silly.
Oh dear, what have I done? Shame, shame on me.
Dog shook himself dry and walked away with his tail tucked between his legs, feeling rather annoyed.
Moral or lesson, don't be greedy.
That silly dog, just like the opinions, always wanting more. They did not like my making up stories about them either. Someone planted a temple treasure in my box. I was accused and convinced of taking it. I was sentenced to death, so they pushed me off a cliff, but I had revenge. Gods cursed Delphi with vengeance and pistols. Lying about someone is really bad. It can get someone killed, but it also kills their reputation. Trust is broken, and it takes a long time to build back up. Just like in our final story, the boy who cried wolf. The boy thinks he's doing something funny, but when it gets serious, nobody believes him.
There was a boy, a shepherd boy, who watched a sheep in the middle. He was in charge of keeping all of the flocks safe.
Every morning, I must take the sheep to the meadow.
I'm bored. There's nothing to do all day but watch these silly sheep eat grass.
The boy stands unhappily in the middle, and he had an idea.
I know. Wouldn't it be fun to fool everyone in the village and nothing ever happens here?
So the boy pretends that a wolf was attacking all of us sheep.
Woof, woof, woof! There's a wolf after my sheep!
All of the new people came running. They brought pitchforks and grabbed the scare of the wolf.
Where's the wolf? There's no wolf in the pasture or the hill or the fields.
There's no wolf.
So the next day, excuse me, munch, 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 life in the pasture was boring for the boy.
Wolf, 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 there are two wolves after my sheep.
Oh my boy, there's no wolves in the meadow or the hill. There are no wolves in the field.
Ha ha, they must have run away.
Said the farmer.
Grr, I smell sheep.
Woof, 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 there's a wolf in the pasture.
This time I'm afraid to say not one townsperson, not two townsperson came to the hill. And sadly, many of my relatives perished that day.
The boy should learn his lesson. No one believes a liar even when they are telling the truth.
I hope you have enjoyed our fable this afternoon. Thank you for coming.
Long ago, there lived a tortoise and a hare. The tortoise was quiet and slow. Hare was fast at everything quickly. Hare was not always nice to others.
Tortoise, hurry up. By the time you finish eating breakfast, it will be time for dinner.
I will try to be a bit faster for you, Hare.
Hare had a habit of teasing Tortoise because he was so slow.
Tortoise, by the time you plant those flowers, it will be winter.
Tortoise never said much back to Hare. He knew he wasn't very fast. But one afternoon, Hare followed Tortoise to his friends. Frog, rat, and rooster.
You are so slow, Tortoise. I could beat you at a race hopping backwards the whole way.
Yes, you could, Hare.
No, Tortoise. You could beat him, Rick.
Yes, with our help you could.
I am sure you can win, Tortoise.
Okay, then. We will race on
faster. Hare hopped off quickly, of course.
You can win.
I don't think I want to race. Hare?
You've got to. You have put up with that nasty hare long enough.
He's not very nice, Tortoise Ribbit.
You can win the race.
Tortoise didn't want to disappoint his friends, so he agreed to race against Hare.
I will help you get in shape before the big race.
I will take you jogging every morning, Ribbit.
I will cheer for you, Tortoise.
Soon, race day was here, and Tortoise was ready. Animals from all over the country came to watch.
This race will begin when I sound this gong. This is a 3-mile course. The red flags mark the course.
The first one to the finish line is the winner.
Take your mark.
Get set.
Go! Ribbit! Hare is moving fast down the runway.
The crowd cheered as Tortoise made it off the starting line.
Hare is so far ahead, he is stopping at Bear's house to get a drink.
Does Hare see that Tortoise just went by Bear's house?
Hare began to run again. He passed Tortoise.
I think I will stop at Rat's house for a snack.
Could that be Tortoise going by?
Oh, that slowpoke Tortoise. I am not worried about him. I already passed him.
Hare finished his snack and hopped out the door. He didn't take long when he passed Tortoise.
This pond over here looks like a lovely, nice place to take a rest.
Hare was sure that he would win the race. He closed his eyes, took a nap, and dreamed of winning the race.
Is that Tortoise coming to the finish line? Ribbit!
I think you are right. That is Tortoise.
Hmm? What? What is that noise?
The crowd was cheering as Tortoise was only steps away from the finish line.
Slow down, Tortoise!
It was too late. Tortoise crossed the finish line just before Hare came running by.
Yeah, Tortoise won the race, rabbit!
I won the race!
Hooray! Our friend won the race!
Yes, you did it, Tortoise!
Hare was angry and upset. There's a valuable lesson to be learned. You don't have to be the best at something to win. Sometimes you just have to keep on trying.
Long ago and far away, in a beautiful land to the east, there was a lovely lake at the bottom of a dancing waterfall. It was surrounded by a green forest and high mountains. There was a great river that flowed from the waterfall into the lake. The lake was teeming with life, with fish, plants, frogs, and even crabs. A lonely heron lived by the lake. He was old, and it was getting hard for him to catch the little juicy fish to eat as they swam by. He was standing at the lake one day, thinking about the lovely meal he would have if he could catch the fish. And he had an idea.
I do love these tasty fish, but I wish they would slow down. My neck hurts from plunging my beak into the water. Let me see if there's a better fishing hole on the other side.
So Heron flew around the shore of the lake. He saw a small pond where the water overflowed a short distance from his usual fishing spot. He hatched a wicked plan. He flew back to put it into action.
Hello, Heron. Getting some exercise today? I saw you flying by earlier.
Hi, Fish. I just got a curious feeling and I thought I would fly by and see if there was any news.
News? What news?
Haven't you noticed that the water level is falling a bit?
Oh, no. But then again, I wasn't looking at the water level.
Hello, Heron.
Hello, Fish. How are you on this fine day?
Hello, Crab. Heron has news.
News? What news do you have, Heron? I saw you fly by earlier today.
Oh, it's dreadful news. We're all in danger.
Danger? Oh no, what do you mean?
When I was flying earlier, I saw the villagers on the other side of the lake. I heard them talking.
Hello, Fish and Crab. Hello, Heron. What is all this commotion?
Hello, Frog. Heron has news.
Can y'all just sit here and tell us news?
I saw you fly by earlier, and what did you find out?
The villagers were saying that they wanted to make the rice field larger. To do that, they wanted to plant a hill terrace. So they had to drain our end of the lake. They even told each other to get baskets to catch all the fish, crabs, and frogs that would be caught up in the field.
Oh no, whatever shall we do? It's impossible to swim out of human basket traps.
This is awful news. I must prepare my family to flee.
Are you sure you heard correctly, Heron? They want our end of the lake?
Oh yes, that's what I heard. I'm preparing to move my nest as soon as I leave them.
But Heron, we fish cannot fly away like these can. Surely you will help us to move too.
Yes, and it'll take them a long time to crawl off to the other side. Do you have any ideas that help us?
Let me think. As I was flying by earlier, I was looking for a new home myself. I saw a little pond by the towards the jungle. The water was clear and there was a lovely shade. Maybe we could share that spot.
Oh, that sounds nice. Could we share?
You forgot our problem. We cannot over there quickly. If that pager are coming, we need to get out soon.
Heron, can you take them away?
Well, you know, I have this pouch in my beak. I guess I could transport everyone in small groups to the pond.
Oh, would you? You're so kind, Heron.
Do you think you could help my family too?
And mine?
Well, it's tiring flying so much. I think I would have to make one trip a day for 3 days. It will take the villagers that long to get the pairs prepared.
My family is ready right now. Oh, please get us out of here.
Oh, Fish, I really want to help you, but I'm old. I must rest after hearing such terrible news. Maybe you can bring your family and meet me at sunset today. And Frog, you can come with your family and meet me tomorrow. And Crab, you can wait for me at the third day.
Oh, Heron, that is a great plan. I will have time to pack.
Oh, Heron, you're so helpful. I will be ready tomorrow.
Are you sure? I have time to wait. You will make the trip today. Why not make the trip tomorrow?
Calm down, everyone. I'll get everyone back in time. Fish, I'll see you later. Frog, I'll see you tomorrow. And Crab, you will be fine waiting an extra day. I'll need some time to digest the moving in. So everyone agreed to Heron's plan, and Fish and the others met him at sunset. Fish brought her brother and some guppies for their great escape.
We're here. Oh, Heron, get us out of here.
Calm down, Fish. I see that you have brought your brother and sister. I'm pretty sure you all fit in my beak. My gull is almost like a pelican's.
Oh, Fish, I wanted to come and wish you well on your journey. Please save my family and I float by the pond.
Yes, Fish, I think this is you soon. Just think, you'll be flying to safety.
Thank you for coming, my friends. Let's say our goodbyes. We don't want to keep Heron waiting.
Well, it's getting late. I wanted to be home by dark.
Let's not delay. I want to get my family out of here. Goodbye, my friends. See you on the other side.
And with that, Heron scooped up Fish and her family and began to fly towards the jungle. There was a pond there, but Heron did not put the fish in there. Instead, he perched in a tall tree beside the pond.
There, he gobbled up Fish and her whole family. He crunched and flapped his wings in delight. He spit the bones on the ground at the bottom of the tree. He was so tired that he spent the night perched in the tree. The next morning, he flew back to the lake to meet Frog.
Hi, Heron. These are two of my brothers and one of my sisters. Can you fit us all?
Hi, Frog. Hi, siblings. Of course I can fit you all in, but you have to be very still or else you'll fall out.
Okay, we will be still. Please get us all here.
So the frogs carefully climbed into Heron's beak. As Heron flew over the tree where he had spent the night, he coughed. All of the frogs fell out of Heron's mouth and smashed onto a nearby rock. Heron feasted on frog legs that night.
The next day, Heron was asleep in a tree on the jungle side of the lake. Crab was waiting for him back at the lake, but a beautiful visitor came to see Crab. It was a Malay bird winged moth. It spied on Heron with the frog and the fish from before. The moth told Crab what had happened. Crab was shocked, then mad. She knew it was her turn next, but she had a plan to keep from being the next meal for Heron. She decided to keep Heron waiting for a bit.
Where's that crab? Here it is, sunset, and my dinner time. I thought he was eager to be rescued.
Here I am. Don't leave without me.
Where were you? What took you so long?
I was trying to persuade that they had to come with us. I told them about our 3 days that night. We may have to come back and get some more crabs after you drop me off.
Well, I'll see how I'm feeling. Maybe I can do one more trip before tomorrow.
Okay, then better get going. I don't think I'll fit inside your beak. I'll hang on your back.
Okay, then. Let's go. So Heron took off with Crab on his back. crab was watching Heron's every move with suspicion. When they flew over the tree and the rock, crab saw the bones of her friends. She had proof for her revenge.
Crab grabbed Heron around the neck with her pincers. Heron tried to cry out, but he could not. He was choking. Crab held tight, pressing on the bird's neck. Soon Heron fell to the ground. His head hit the very rock that the frogs had. Heron became the meal that night instead of the diner, because all of the crabs had gotten the news and were waiting to pick the meat off his bones. Crab herself was carried to the ground on Heron's soft feathers and lived.
Midas was a very rich king. It seemed like he had everything a king could ever want. He lived in a big castle and had a daughter that he loved. He also had a lot of gold. One day when King Midas was walking outside admiring his castle, he found someone unexpected.
Hello there. You look like an interesting fella. Who might you be?
I am a satyr, as you probably noticed. I'm a half man and a half goat.
Well, since you mentioned it, I did notice that you are not from around here. I am King Midas, and this is my kingdom. I feel sure if I would have remembered if a man with hooves and a tail would live nearby.
You're quite right, Your Majesty. I do not live near here. I'm a friend of Dionysus, the god of revelry. We were traveling, celebrating something. Dionysus always celebrates something. We decided to rest under this lovely old tree, but I have must fallen asleep and was left behind.
Don't worry, Satyr. I'm sure Dionysus will return for you. While we wait for him, come inside my castle. We can have dinner and you can meet my daughter. We'd love to hear your stories about what is life traveling around such a cheerful guy.
Oh,
I'm sure you two have lots of fun.
Yes, we do. We won't believe what happened this one time.
They had a very nice dinner with the satyr, entertaining everyone with funny tales from his travels. They were all sleepy after dinner, so Midas welcomed the satyr to stay as a guest. The next day, Dionysus, the god of revelry, came looking for an old friend.
Satyr, there you are.
I was so worried when I noticed that you were missing.
I guess I fell asleep and nobody noticed. I'm fine though. King Midas has fed me delicious food and gave me a very comfortable bed to sleep in.
I'm very surprised that we didn't notice you sleeping as we left. Usually, you snore so loud that the whole kingdom would know that you were napping. Anyway, King Midas, I must thank you for taking such good care of my friend. The last king we visited wanted to stay to sleep in the stables with the animals. They were worried he might have fleas.
I didn't have fleas. I was scratching against this tree because it felt good. I must have had dry skin.
Calm down, my friend. The point is that the King Midas was very kind. As a reward, I'll grant him one wish of anything he chooses. So, follow me, King Midas. Think carefully. You get only one wish.
Oh, I know what I want. I don't need any time to think about it. I wish everything I touch turned to gold.
Are you sure you don't need to think about it more carefully?
No. I am very sure. I want more gold. I can never have enough gold.
Very well. When you wake up the next morning, you will get a golden touch.
When King Midas woke up the next morning, he was very excited to see if his wish had been granted. He jumped out of bed and touched a small wooden table. It turned to gold. He touched a chair, a doorknob, a bowl, and many other items in his castle. They all instantly turned into gold. Midas was very happy. He saw his daughter in the garden and picked his favorite flower to give to her.
Thank you, Father. I love the smell of roses. But this is strange. The rose has no smell. Why is it made of gold?
Here, let's sit down for breakfast. And I'll explain. Something very interesting happened yesterday.
Yes, Father. Oh, wait! Don't eat that grape. Look what happened. You picked up the food and it turned into gold. How will you eat or drink anything now? I'm worried about you. Your wish seems more like a curse.
Don't be upset, Volta. Everything will be okay.
Without thinking of what would happen, Midas hugged her daughter. He only meant to comfort her, but instead turned her to gold too.
Oh no, what have I done? My daughter was right. The golden touch is a curse. I thought gold was the most important thing in the world to me. Please, Dionysus, if you can hear me, free me from this and return my daughter to me.
I have heard you, King Midas. Because you were so kind to my friend the Sager, I will release you from your wish. Go down to the river and wash your hands. The golden touch will be being carried away by the water.
Midas did as he was told and returned back to his castle, where he found his daughter safe and sound. He realized that gold was not the most important thing, even though he still had a lot of gold, so he wanted to share it with his kingdom.
Yay!
Three cheers for King Midas, such a wise and generous king!
Once upon a time, there was a handsome prince who was very fond of hunting. He provided meat for the poor people in his kingdom and had many hunting trophies on the palace walls. One day, he traveled far beyond where he normally hunted to a dark jungle forest.
What happened next would change his life.
Well, my pickles did. I think we may have gone too far today. But we only need to turn around and we will end up back home. Isn't that right? Hey, what are those on trees? Maybe we'll bring on home noon. Yeah.
Prince Amir lifted his bow and took aim at the colorful birds. But before he could shoot, there was a flurry of feathers and fierce squawk.
Stop! Hop! Do not shoot! I am the Raja Kota, the Raja of all parrots. Please let me live, and I can tell you about Princess Maya.
Princess who? Who's that? Why would I want to know about her?
Ah, the Princess Maya. Are you married, engaged, spoken for, dating anyone?
I'm truly single. Now, get on with it. Who is Princess Maya? Where does she live? I assume she's available, since you brought it up.
She is available, but her father, Radha Dilip, will not let her marry anyone. I see by your noble steed and golden hilt on your horse that you have enough money. Is there anything else about you that would make your future father-in-law happy?
I'm Prince Tamir. I'm from the kingdom next over. But why would I want to marry the princess? What makes her so special?
Ah, the princess, the beautiful Princess Maya. What can I say? She's as radiant as the moon, warm and gentle as the evening sun. In this great world, she is beyond compare.
So, how would I find her?
You will have to go through the deep jungle. Then you will come to a wide plain. Across this plain is the kingdom of Rajendra, her father. You will see the palace and Princess Maya lives inside. Just go forward, ever forward, and you will find her.
Thank you, Raja Kota. Perhaps I will journey to find this princess.
The prince rode back to his own castle. He had his horse fed and watered, and he spoke with his parents about the lovely Princess Maya. His mother cried because she did not want him to go so far away. His father argued about his readiness for marriage. But in the end, they helped him pack food for the journey, and his mother gave him a beautiful ring to take to the princess as a gift.
I want them all.
No, I get them all. I'm the only girl.
I'm the oldest. They are mine.
Oh, there. What is all this commotion? I could hear you arguing from all far off.
Our mother died and left us these. I want them all.
You're so selfish, not even thinking about sharing.
Sharing is dumb. You need all three to finish the job.
What job? What things? They look like pile of junk.
They're not junk. The bag will give you anything you ask for.
The rope around your butt will tie up your enemy. And so they can escape, and and the stick will beat them up.
And the carpet is my favorite. It will take you anywhere you want to go. And I want to get as far away from you two as possible.
Is that so? Maybe I can help you to decide. I shall take 3 arrows and shoot them into the air. The first one of you that brings me an arrow back can't have all the treasures.
That is a great idea. I have no problem because I'm the fastest.
You think you are? You will have to beat me. I train with cheaters. Beat this.
Take care. Good luck. Bon voyage. Let's see what we have inside you. I hope they weren't kidding around. I can use these items. I don't know for what, but I'll find something. Okay, my noble steed. I don't need you, and a stick. And a magic carpet. Go home now. Go on. Carpet, take me to where Princess Maya is.
The carpet slowly rose into the air and flew smoothly and steadily over the forest and across the plains. It landed in front of a beautiful palace. The prince gazed about to look at it.
Madame. I must ask you something.
Yes? What is it, young man?
Is this the city where the Princess Maya lives?
Oh, yes, it is so. We are so blessed.
How can I find her?
Every evening, the princess comes to sit on the palace roof. She stays for about an hour, and her beauty lights up the city. Then she sings her goodnight song and goes into her bed.
So, it is true. She does live here. The carpet proof is not working. I must gauge up in the princess. Wow, Rosa Tote and the old lady weren't kidding. The princess is gorgeous. She must have many suitors. I must do something extraordinary to get her to notice me. Bad, give me a shawl to match Princess Maya, Majesty Saru.
The carpet rose up and floated over the wall of the palace. It finally landed on the floor of the princess' room. She was asleep. The next night, the prince stood outside the palace and watched Princess Maya light up the sky and sing her beautiful song. He thought of another gift for the princess.
Beg, give me a necklace of diamonds and pearls to match my mother's ring. Carpet, take me up to the Princess Maya.
Again, the carpet rose up and floated over the wall of the palace. It quietly landed on the floor of the princess' room. She was again asleep. On the third night, the prince stood outside the palace and watched Princess Maya light up the sky and sing her beautiful song. He thought of another gift for the princess. It was the gift that he had brought with him.
Carpet, take me up to Princess Maya.
Again, the carpet quietly floated up to the princess' room. Instead of leaving the ring on the bed, the prince gently lifted the princess's hand and put the ring on her finger. She blinked her eyes and sat up.
Please don't go. Tell me your name.
Oh, lovely princess. I did not mean to wake you.
I'm glad you did. I wanted to thank you for the lovely gifts. Please, sir, what is your name?
I'm Hamir.
I'm Maya. Tell me, is there something you want? Something I can give you in return?
Yes, there is. You can give me your hand in marrying. Tell me all about yourself.
They talked together for the rest of the night. The next morning, Princess Maya took Prince Hamir to meet her father.
Daddy, here's someone I want you to meet. This is Prince Hamir from our neighboring kingdom. He has asked me to marry him. Let me introduce my father, Raja the Weak.
Good morning, Raja Dalit. Yes, I want to marry your daughter.
You marry my Maya? We are strangers here. We know nothing about you.
But Daddy, we talked all night. I know much about him, and I want to marry him.
So you are entertaining a strange man during the night? Have you no shame?
Oh no, it's not what you think. Her beauty captured my interest. But her heart and my mind were revealed to me during our talk. She is beautiful, inside and out.
Well, at least you see her work. She is my daughter. I just want her to be happy.
It is my plan to make her happy. There is nothing I wouldn't do.
Oh good, because I have a task for you. To prove you're worthy marrying my daughter. Outside the city lives a fearsome ogre. He is as tall as two men, as wide as three, and as strong as six. Every day there's a report of him stealing or killing. My soldiers have had trouble defeating him, and my people are scared of him. If you can capture this ogre, you may marry him tomorrow.
I'm on my way, Brother Khalid.
Please, you know, feel my prince.
Put the prince sat on his trusty carpet and used his magic to locate the ogre. He made sure to bring the bag, rope, and stick with him. Since the ogre lived just outside the city, it was a short trip.
Now, I wonder where that ogre could be. I wonder why Brother Bell cannot catch him with all his soldiers. Wait, what is that noise? What is this awful smell?
What are you doing on my land? Who are you?
I'm Prince Hamir. I have come to win the hand of the Prince Maya. She will come with me. We don't need to fight. We do not need to fight.
Come with you where? I will not follow a Raja Dalit soldier. I'm sure not to follow a stranger.
I know nothing about you. Just what I have done, hold. I'm only half here to do my job, so I can marry the princess. Did you say this was your land?
Yes, it's my land. The Raja Dalit has forgotten. His father promised to me long ago before the palace walls were built. This kingdom was just villages on the plain. The big cats from the jungle would terrorize us, killing our young. The villagers looked to me for protection. When I got rid of the cats, the attack stopped. The villagers gave me this land as payment. For the help, Raja Dalit's father had the palace walls built. But he told me I could always stay here on the land. Raja Dalit has forgotten?
But Raja Dalit says that you steal and kill. Every day, there's a new attack. Who am I supposed to believe?
Since I'm here, believe me. You are the first to stop and listen to me. Everyone else is start hitting, yelling, and shooting. If there is killing going on, the jungle cats could be back. The stealing, I'm not sure. Don't want to just a few people.
I really don't want to get in the middle of this. I just want to marry the princess. You seem pretty nice. I can get you an audience with the Raja if you will come with me.
The Raja hides behind his wall. He won't talk to me there. Maybe if you bring him to me, only you, that is no soldier. If he came here alone, maybe he could be reasoned with.
For me to get Brother Dalit here without a escort, I would help to kidnap him. What does not make me look good as a future soldier?
That's my offer. Take it or leave it. Now that's a good idea. How will you test your love if you never go through adversity? Wait, what do I hear? What do I smell?
Smell? How can you smell anything besides yourself?
I hear a panther. I will take care of him. You get the Raja over here.
So Prince Hamir went back to the palace. He found the princess and told her everything. She agreed to help and brought her father to the prince's chambers.
Maya, why are you leading me to the guest chambers? Who am I meeting?
Father, it will be all right. Just trust me.
Hello, Prince Hamir. Have you captured the ogre? Is he one of my cells?
No, sir, but I met him outside the palace walls. He told a convincing story of how he was given the land by the villagers protecting them from the jungle cats.
My father took over that land. Now that he's gone, it's mine.
If you will come with me, we can discuss this with the ogre. He's fine fellow. He just wants to be hard.
I will not go that old smelly ogre. You were supposed to bring him to me.
He does not trust you. You will not listen to him. Just like you're not listening to me. Ralph, do your work. First thing.
So they carried Raja Dalip outside of the palace walls, all tied up and rolled up in a carpet. They met with the ogre as the prince unrolled the rug. The ogre laid a panther's pelt next to it.
Hello, Raja Dalip. Thank you for coming out here. I think I have found what has been causing the killing around the villages. This panther here.
Oh my, are there more?
What, sir? I can't hear you.
Please untie me, I need to meet with my subject.
So the prince and princess untied the Raja. He listened to the ogre's story and it brought up memories of hearing conversations with the ogre and his father. So he agreed to letting the ogre keep his land in exchange for continued protection from the jungle cats. The ogre was also asked to observe the Raja's soldiers to see if anyone was stealing. The prince and princess had a beautiful wedding and everyone lived happily ever after.
Apesar de fogo, que no olho, como o coração na festa.